tide is sailing. So you know what that's like. It's time to tune in with Mona on Lots of Tea tonight.
She's famous, she went all night, and the way this song just right.
She's gonna spill the tea on the top show tonight. We're gonna speak on topics that might be hard to take. We'll understand we gotta until the whole wide world awake. Let's not waste another moment and get on with the show. Cause it's time to get things started. Why are we getting started?
You better get things started.
On the most sensational, informational, celebrational, conversational. Now it's time for Mona and the show.
Happy Thursday, everyone. It's good to see you all. We had a week off because of it was an extra Thursday. So it's good to see you all here. I've got a little brown spot on my screen, and it looks like it's like right here. And it made it look like a little witch's mole on my chin. But we're glad to be here with all of you tonight. It's been busy, busy. We got some shows coming this weekend. I will be Saturday night at Moonbase in Kent, Ohio. So come down and see us there with Danielle Vasquez, and Alejandra Love is going to be there. I forget, Mani, is it? I forget. And then on Sunday,
Carmen Dupree. Whatever the rest.
Okay. And then Sunday I will be in Columbus, Ohio, at South Bend with the lovely Denise Russell. Can't wait for that show. I will be singing some songs and having fun. It's a potluck, little lunch thing. I think that show starts at 2:00. Or 3:00, 2:00, I think the doors open and you can have lunch and all that good stuff. So come in and see us. And not much else going on, just getting ready for winter. It seems like our nights are freezing cold here. We haven't really had hot nights.
Up and down.
I don't like, not like normal summer nights. They've been cold. So everybody's been cold. It's been freezing here. Yeah. But we've got a good show coming up tonight. We're really excited about. It is... Hi, Pam. I miss you so much. I hope you're feeling well. How's everything going down there? And if you notice, hi, Ed Copeland, you have not been here in a million years. I haven't seen you on. It's good to see you here on the show. And of course, he goes everywhere but to North Carolina. Well, get me booked down there, sir. Speaking of Brian, he's going to be our guest tonight, my cousin Brian. We'll talk a little bit more about that when we bring him on. Hi, Karen. Good to see you. And all that good stuff. So we have a large margin will not be here tonight. But before I get into why, we're going to show you why. She tore her ACL last Thursday. Now, officially, an 8.5 drag performer. She was so excited to do that. Notice StreamYard has changed. Ever see that I'm in a circle? I can do that now. Mm-hmm. I love it. Instead of being the whole screen, like in your face. But Large March, she performed and she tore it up. She did such a good job. Well, she tore her ACL too. But so that's why she's not here with us tonight. So not only did she perform, but another of our production people here goes by the name of Talk-A-Lots. And she also performed. Here's Angel's performance.
From right here in Asheville County, this is Taka Lots.
I need to open them.
The wig change and costume change. Look at this. Yes! I thought she was going to do a death drop at one point. She thought about it. But she did do this little spin right here. Yes! Twirling her. So they had a good time. I'm so proud of both of them. They did an amazing job. You know, and the next day I told Large Marge, I said, well, now you can officially say that you're an AFAB queen and you performed. So now get ready because you're going to be performing more. And she's like, oh, she's like, I don't know how people do it. I'm like, I know, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. I'm only just, you know, because I went and painted Angel and then I went over to painted her. And then they went and did their little thing. And, you know, you have to still do the whole kit and caboodle, the whole thing. So I'm so proud of them. So I hope you guys enjoyed that for a little bit. So taking her place tonight is our one and only resident astrologer, Mr. Anthony. How are you, sir?
I'm good. How are you?
Great. It's great to see you. Hi, Chris. It's great to see you, honey. Miss you as well. So what's been going on with you?
Life. I've been kind of keeping to myself. I have a little garden I have out back here, so I've been tending to my garden, playing with my dog, doing lots of studying.
Nice.
But I'm preparing for this time of year is always like pretty busy with like festivals. So I'm preparing to do actually this weekend. I'm participating in a psychic fair in Vallant, Pennsylvania, which is my second year doing it. It's pretty cool.
Where at?
Vallant, it's right outside of Grove City, Pennsylvania.
Oh, okay. So just like right around the corner.
Yeah, it's like an hour away, but it's like right around the corner from Grove City, yeah.
Okay. So how does that work when you're at a psychic fair?
Well, I'll be doing tarot readings, but I am offering like intuitive astrology, which it's like I listen to my intuition. I mean, looking at a astrology chart, you know, you can go off of that. That's like a bit scientific, you know, there's like points to point to. But when you take a more intuitive approach, which is how I started out, let me start over. When giving like a traditional astrology reading, you start with like the sun, moon, and rising. In evolutionary astrology, which is the practice that I use, you look at Pluto and what Pluto's doing, because that points to like your soul's evolutionary intent, like the bigger picture thing.
Yeah.
But with intuitive astrology, it's like looking at a chart and like feeling someone's energy and kind of letting that guide where to look in the chart. So, so it's still astrology, but there's a more like psychic or intuitive approach to it.
Very good.
So, but I'll be doing tarot too.
All right. Very nice.
Yeah.
And there is just, so much in the world going on right now. I can't even imagine what's going on in the universe.
Yeah. Yeah, it could be a bit overwhelming, but I just try to remind myself that it's all for the greater good, you know? Like any of us that are going through things that seem a bit tough, I'm not trying to take away from the toughness that you're feeling, but it's important to remind yourself that there's always a reason that we go through these things, you know? There's a lesson to be learned or an opportunity to show kindness or choose love over hate, you know? So,
yeah.
Now, I try to instill that in all my messages or all my readings.
It's wonderful. Now, I heard, I think it was last week, I was watching some, you know, a reel or something on TV, on Facebook, because we're energy, we have energy, right?
Correct.
And that shoes are the worst thing for us.
What are?
Shoes.
Yeah, well.
That we should go out and put our feet on the ground and like recharge. And I walk barefoot all the time. I have Fred Flintstone feet. I can walk across gravel.
Yeah. Yeah, it's called grounding.
Grounding.
But yeah, the plastic in shoes, like there's actually some new, I can't think of the name of the brands, but there's some new shoe lines out there that use a different, not like plastic for the bottom of the shoes so that it doesn't stop that current exchange between the earth and us. But yeah, wearing shoes is not the most like energetically sound because you're like blocking yourself off from being connected to the earth.
Yeah. And you wonder, like, you know, why were shoes invented? Was it to keep us from being grounded? You never know.
Well, I mean, they do help us from like stepping on thorns and stuff. But
yeah.
And like, I mean, if you remember in the like early 2000s, like all those pictures of Britney Spears, like in bathrooms at gas stations, like there's like a cleanliness hygiene factor too.
True.
But they even
sell, just have like, a doormat. You have a foot washing station at your house.
Yeah. 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 Well, I mean, in like Eastern cultures, a lot of people like being barefoot in the house is like very important. You know, like you would never bring in dirty energy from the streets.
That's how I was raised. Like my dad always used to tell me, like, even if you're walking into someone's house and they have a dirt floor, you're taking your shoes off. And it's just natural habit to me. I can't do it. I mean, I don't care if people walk in my house with their shoes on. I mean, I have dogs, you know, so they walk barefoot. But I just can't
do that. That connection to the earth is really important. That's why, like, time in nature, like hugging trees. They even sell like these like grounding mats that you can put in your bed. That like
really
go. They like go over the edge of the mattress and like touch the ground, and they create a connection current that you can kind of like recharge or ground while you're sleeping.
Oh, I love that. I'll have to check those out. Probably on Amazon.
I'm sure
they do. Well, it's good for you to be here tonight. Do you want to share now your little thing that you had that you were going to talk about?
Because
it was, you know, we talked before the show, and he shared some things about what's going on right now, and I said, yeah, share, because it's pretty beneficial for everyone.
Yeah, I think we actually talked about it in a prior episode. But what I wanted to discuss was Pluto. The planet Pluto just on September 1st, retrograded back into Capricorn. So let me start with, planet as an archetype represents, it's like the Lord of the underworld. It's like death, transformation, like deeper subconscious, motives, which we all have a personal connection to Pluto. But because Pluto moves really slow, it is a very generational thing. So depending on what year you're born in, like you're part of a Pluto generation. So Pluto is going to be moving into, it's kind of been doing this dance back and forth between Capricorn and Aquarius. But it'll like officially, it's just moved back into Capricorn for the last time in like 244 years, 244.1 years, I believe. That's how long it takes for Pluto to go all the way around. So this will be the last time for a long time that it'll be in Capricorn. It moved into Capricorn in 2008. And when that, so every time Pluto moves into a new sign, it kind of like brings this intensity that Pluto's known for. And while it was in Capricorn, it kind of not kind of, it brought forth a lot of change, like societal change, around like power structures, especially with like banking. Like we had the like banking crisis in 2008, 2009, the housing bubble, like all these things like Pluto kind of ushered in and transformed. So the reason I wanted to talk about it was because when it moves, when it moved back into Capricorn, it's been in Aquarius for the past few months. And like I said, it moves really slow, so it didn't get very far before it went back again. But it's important that while it makes this transition one last time for a really long time, that we kind of like tie up loose ends in this part of our chart. So what you want to do is look at the Capricorn area of your chart and look for 29 degrees. And depending on what house it's in, it will show like where this personal transformation is occurring for you, and where you can like work with it and kind of like learn the lessons. But basically it's like, it's asking us to relook at like commitments and things that we need to figure out so that we can grow with society and not be on the underbelly of it. Pluto's energy is a very, it has a dark to it. But it's kind of
necessary. You cut like, out there for a second. It has a what?
There's like a darkness to it.
A darkness to it.
Or like a heaviness. But it's just like anything in life, like death. So Pluto is Hades, the ruler of the underworld. And, you know, that we're all scared of death, but it's a necessary part of life, you know? Yeah. So without death, things can't be reborn. So, but once it moves into Aquarius, you know, well, I don't want to go too far into that because we still do have this last little bit of Pluto in Capricorn. I believe it's still like November 19th, somewhere around there. So these next few months, like we might, and it's, so there's certain degrees called critical degrees in astrology. And they're just like what the term states. It's like there's like an intensity around that. In 29 degrees, the last degree of any sign is a critical degree. So there might be like this last hurrah of like Pluto and Capricorn themes. Like, you know, look at the world. Like Pluto and Capricorn energy is like top down. It's like corporations, like, you know. That's changing. Like the world's changing. Like these things are kind of falling. Money, like our money systems, education systems. That's a great word for Capricorn systems. And Pluto wants to like wreck it down so that we can build back up again, like better and stronger. So these last few months of Pluto and Capricorn are going to be intense. I mean, look at in the US, we have the election coming up. This is a very like, you know, intense time. And then moving into Aquarius, like I said, Pluto takes a really long time to go around, right? So the last time that it was in Aquarius was like in the 1777 to 1797, I believe. And if you look at that time period, it was like the Haitian, the Haitian and French Revolution and the American Civil War, right? So it's like,
oh wow,
yeah. So it's like this, the era that we're moving into, like that sounds like really, you know, dramatic, and it can be like this is Aquarian energy is very like it's all about the revolution. It's all about like forward momentum, you know. War is not a good thing, right? And I'm not putting out there that that's what's going to happen, but Pluto does like demand transformation in Aquarius. Energy demands for like progression, right? Okay. So this is just something to like keep in mind. And during this time where this dance between Capricorn and Aquarius happens, it's like this internal calling of arms, I would say, like that's like tapping into the things in us. Pluto like represents the subconscious and like the deeper desires that are fueling us that we're not aware of, right? So like for you, you do a lot of what your voice is used to uplift people who need, you know, support or like need community, whether that be trans, like, you know what you do. We all know what you do. But this time period is going to, like, really trigger those things in us to hopefully help us stand up and, you know, whether that be in finances, education, politics, whatever that might be. Like, this is a time where Pluto's going to kind of push us to do the thing that we feel like needs our attention.
So, All right. So pay attention to what you need to
Yeah. But like, it's like a subconscious desire. So it's like when you're watching TV or reading the newspaper or having a conversation with someone, those things that are like bubbling underneath you that are like, that just doesn't sit right with me. Listen to those things, because that's where you'll understand where you need to, like, yeah, step up and act up or like act out in a way that will bring forth revolution in your own world. You know, like, I'm not saying go burn down government buildings or anything like that, but Right. Get out and vote, like, stand up and like put forth the effort to make change happen, you know, for the things that you feel need to change. Like I said, it could be the financial situation that we're in, education, like kids, corporations as a whole, you know, like, yeah.
Very good. Thank you for sharing that. Appreciate it. We're going to go into a commercial break right now. Hope everybody got that good message from Anthony. And we will be right back with our special guest, my cousin, Brian Reif.
Hey everyone, it's Mona Lutz. You know, everyone always asks me where I get my beautiful necklaces from. Well, that's easy. It's Team BFF from Paparazzi. Look them up on Facebook. They're easy to find. Team BFF from Paparazzi. Where would my social media be without Kish Photography? They offer various photo sessions, an outside-of-the-box experience offered by doing these sessions in select locations that are not confined by walls. Angel has a selection of prints of various scenes and animals that are available for purchase as well. Kish Photography.
Are you and your family looking for the perfect puppy? Well, what if I told you that would be simple? You'd probably say that I was crazy, right? Because we all know, raising a new puppy is never simple. But Truvy and her littermates went through what is called puppy culture, where they were given obstacles and challenges at the early age of 2 weeks old. They listen to fireworks and thunderstorms, so they're used to it. And they don't respond to it when it happens. Many other things, just like being housebroken and crate trained. She even sits down when it's time to eat instead of jumping all around like a crazy puppy. You don't believe me? Here, watch this.
Mommy Jill has made a good impression, hasn't she? Because her sick every day when I get her food, and when we go over here, because we're going to fill her water, and she's real excited about it. And what? She'll go and sit. And she'll go over here and sit. Since her's a good girl, she makes a dream. Watch this excitement right here. And I'm gonna put a little water in it right here. And it goes right through her bowl there and knows where her bowl is. And eats her breakfast.
So, if you're ready for that perfect puppy, contact Jill at 440-858-7273 or contact her at Facebook at Muddy Puppy Farm. Puppy's so good, you'll be glad they're a muddy puppy.
Oh my god, you guys. I just thought that I was hitting the video button, but I hit the take a picture button, and we're gonna look at this is what my picture looks like right here. But anyway, listen. Earlier I took two of these gummies. Okay. All right, they were delicious. Oh my god. All right, bye.
Here we are. We're back. Yay. And it is my pleasure to introduce our special guest. He is my cousin from North Carolina. And his father and my father are...
Oh, God.
Jesus. Our fathers are triplets, as we've said before. Notice his last name is spelled different than mine because people in West Virginia don't know how to spell. He only wrote it three times. Ryan, so thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. I can't believe it's been how long since I've been on the show.
This is your first time.
I know.
And you probably wouldn't have been here had you not sent me a message telling me I should put you on the show.
I'm glad to be here. I first want to say I'm extremely proud of you.
Thank you.
As your cousin. For everything that you do for the community and for this show. I love watching the show when I get a chance and getting to officially meet Anthony.
Hey.
Had a little connection where when I first met Anthony, he was telling me about how he wanted to be a life coach and things like that. And I said, well, my cousin.
Yeah. The name went ding, ding, ding. even though I'm getting old, it takes a little bit for it to check in with my brain here.
So you are the director of
quality assurance for the National Certification Council for Activity Professionals. So people are like, what the heck is that? What does that mean? There's a profession that actually provides care in healthcare, such as a hospital setting, an assisted living, continuing care retirement community and nursing homes, adult daycares, those types of living situations. And what that person does is that they provide engagement, whether it's through painting, music, arts, crafts, leisure programming. It's just anything to fuel the soul, to keep you going. I always say it's one of the best professions that is in the country that nobody knows about. Without an activity professional in these communities, these residents really have nothing. And that the point was proven during COVID. When COVID started and the facility shut down and the residents were confined to their rooms for a year, some residents had to stay in their room. They never saw the light of day. They only saw the nurse, the therapist, or one activity person. They never saw their family. And, if you got rid of activities or the activity profession, that means there's no windows, there's no radio, there's nothing to read, there's no communication, there's no talking. people would just pass away. And they kind of did that anyway during COVID because of the limited amount of engagement. They didn't have their families coming in to see them. So it's a pretty important profession. So if you need more information about how to become an activity professional, you can email me or reach me, or Mona can put some information in the chat box. And I'll be glad to share that with you.
Absolutely. Now, with the whole reason why you're here tonight, tying it into the LGBTQ community, is because we rarely even think about it. And I just took the first part of the course, which was the professional level, with Brian. And I've known, you know, Brian has always, this has been his profession, his activities. I mean, he has done amazing things that I wish I could share all of the things that he's done, the videos and things that he has done with, it's almost like Make-A-Wish for the elders, right? Isn't that kind of what you did? You're just like Make-A-Wish.
Yeah, there was, I developed an award-winning program called Magic Moments, and one of the biggest things that I ever accomplished was there was a baby boomer who was stuck in a nursing home from severe rheumatoid arthritis. It was very crippling. She was contracted. Her jaw was contracted. All of her limbs were contracted, and she was from actually Ohio and Cincinnati, and she had her and her family, her husband and her two kids moved to North Carolina to be in a warmer climate. And when she was hospitalized because of a severe episode of rheumatoid arthritis while she was hospitalized, her husband left her. And she was teaching. She was a calculus teacher and a civil engineer. And the church that she was part of, they flew her children back home to Ohio to her mom and sister so that they could raise them. And when I would go to visit her in her room, because she couldn't come out, she was completely bedridden. She would just say, I want to go home. That's all I want. I just want to go home. And it was going to cost about $10,000 to get her home. Nobody wanted to donate money because we were a for-profit nursing facility. And there was like no hope. And I worked on this for many, many, many months. And right when I got ready to throw in the towel, Second Wind Dreams, which grants wishes of nursing home residents, they contacted me and they actually got a free medical flight to fly her home. So it was about 3 days before Thanksgiving, she found out. And I had to find a nursing home for her to go live at. I had to get the doctor's approval for her to fly. And she was a straight Medicaid patient. And if you don't know what that means, it means that the facility will not make any money on this patient. And she had rheumatoid arthritis medication. She was a tube feed. And all of those are extremely expensive for a nursing home to have to pay for. And I actually found a nursing home 4 miles from her family that agreed to take her. And it was just one of the biggest accomplishments of my life. I'll never forget it. And
that's on YouTube, right?
Yes.
So you can probably search it and find it. And the whole story, like if we're getting in the airplane and the airplane leaving. And
it's pretty fabulous. That's amazing. She made a thumbprint. She left a little sparkle on me.
Yeah. You have a hard time even still now talking about it.
I do. I talk about her in class and I share the video in class and I cry every time I share it. You know, it's just these people, and the reason why I'm here tonight is to talk about these people that live in these communities and, you know, what are we going to do for them or what can we do for them? And tonight's topic, of course, is the LGBTQ plus elderly people.
And unfortunately, we're going to have to let you go because I just read the bottom of your name, like your name.
Just be long enough.
Show tonight.
I'm not the only one slowing down.
So yeah, we're bringing that whole LGBTQ because you don't really think about it. Like when you get older, you're still gay. And if you get put in a nursing home or assisted living or something, what do you go through? And especially like the people that are there now, they're not from this generation. They went through all the hardships and the fear and stuff. So we're going to watch this clip right here before we get into it a little heavier.
lot of people believe that you just live happily ever after, and that just is a myth.
People like ourselves, older, are hiding in nursing homes or whatever because they are scared to death.
It's incredibly common to go back into the closet again.
You just know when they don't want you there.
We've heard about homemakers going in, taking out a Bible and having the elder pray and asking for forgiveness.
And to be cured. It's not too late for you to be cured of this. They go back in the closet. She might mistreat me or abuse me.
They're so afraid of it, they are resisting any kind of medical attention.
That person was in their mid-20s during the McCarthy era.
The closet was the norm.
They could lose their job, they could lose, you know, families.
We were sick.
Just
we were
sick, sick,
sick we were people. Considered sick.
People were involuntarily hospitalized in psychiatric facilities.
Even electroshock.
The degradation of these people is so complete that their sex satisfaction come only in being tortured themselves.
I was on the route to the nut farm.
So there's a real distrust of mainstream institutions.
I would never put myself in danger.
Time well spent.
He became much more fearful of people knowing that he was gay.
You're not leaving now, are you?
Not right now.
LGBT elders are more likely than the general population to age alone because many never had children. Many have not had great relationships with their families of origin. There would be a higher degree of sort of alienation and isolation.
My family was the reason I existed, and I lost them all. If they ever choose to catch up before I die, I welcome them.
LGBT aging issues are an epidemic.
There's a small and growing group of us.
We're trying to go into the existing network so they become more inclusive. One of the most common lines we get is like, we don't have any gay elders here.
If I wasn't the only person responsible for Alexander, I would have ended my life.
This is our life.
Good to see you!
Stairway to paradise,
with a new step every day.
We have a whole generation of people who don't know who we are. That's really sad, because you're missing out on a lot. We know a lot. We did a lot for you. You wouldn't be here if it weren't for us.
You keep on screwing me. Too bad I don't have an open casket.
Well, there'll be no open casket. There won't be anything, right?
If we are saying come out and be filled with pride, it's our responsibility to make sure that continues right through their last day.
Wow.
That documentary is it's from 2010, and you can watch it. You can find it on YouTube. But it's about the lives of six LGBTQ plus seniors living in the Boston area that are dealing with discrimination, abuse. You saw the couple in the nursing home. Every time I see them, it just makes me, I get a little teary eyed because I think of, you know, yeah. That's going to be me and my spouse someday, you know,
yeah.
And we've really got to start doing something. We should have been doing it all along, but now's the time to start doing something and educating our communities, healthcare communities on, you know, what they need to do and how that they can be inclusive and be a safe space. You know, it's we have abuse in healthcare and nursing homes and these types of communities anyway. You know, LGBTQ plus out of the equation, there's still abuse. But then you add this layer onto it. You know, imagine imagine being a person like us in these facilities and being abused.
You can't run away from it.
No.
You're not able to go home. That is your home. You're not really able to, right. to flee the situation. So you're kind of stuck there. You know, which I always want to scream, you know, if you're in healthcare, you can't be biased. Like, you have to be, you can't be, you know, you can't be prejudiced of any way in any kind of healthcare. You shouldn't be. You should be removed from that job. Right. But what are the statistics, would you say, for LGBTQ in the senior living?
So from 2000, there's a study that estimates between 2010 and the year 2030 that there's going to be as many as 7 million LGBTQ plus.
And when?
Between 2010 and 2030. 7 so million.
20 years total. 7 million.
7 million.
Wow. Elderly.
Million. That goes from baby boomers and then up, and then the new people coming in, the babies. So to be 7 million, that's a lot.
And what's that age range?
So it would be the baby boomer age, so 55 plus, and then within those the studies, because we have people that are, you have people that are coming into the communities that are young people that are maybe they've had motor vehicle accidents or drug use or this day and age now, especially suicide attempts, you know, so that adds to that number. Which to me is just a lot.
I think a lot of people forget that too, that it's not just elderly people too that are in these assisted livings and nursing homes. There are the people, like you said, motorcycle accidents and things like right. that, where they're crippled or paraplegic or what have you, and their family doesn't have the means to take care of them, so they or don't want to take care of them, and they go to the homes. And
there's actually some nursing facilities that have babies that live there.
You're kidding me.
No, that's something we don't talk about in class, but
yeah.
there are some facilities that have infants that live in there. So just because, you know, their families can't take care of them for whatever reason, or they've been abandoned.
Yeah,
you know, they become a dumpster or something. Ward of the state or whatnot, and they have to be placed somewhere. You know, sometimes foster homes aren't a place, or their waiting placement or whatever. But there are some. I've taught some students that have worked at communities that have had, you know, children that live there.
That blows my mind. Nothing really should surprise any of us these day and age. So yeah, so 7 million people, and I mean, you hear these poor people, like, you know, the fear and going back in the closet, or even committing suicide themselves at their age.
Yeah, you know, the female couple that was in the video, they were still living at home, but they were, you know, they're thinking. Well, the one had to use the elevator to go up the steps. You saw that. And I think in the video, you know, they talk about, or in the movie, the documentary, they talk about not wanting to go into a community because, you know, you can't just go in and love on your lover.
Yeah.
If you're LGBTQ plus, you should.
Even though you technically have the right to.
Right. Right. Absolutely. But, you know, you have somebody that is judgmental. They can cause a lot of issues. There's been stories of people that have, you know, that the resident, the staff know that they're LGBTQ plus, and they've been abused, been, you know, assaulted or whatnot on a certain shift, like second or third shift when there's not a lot of management staff there.
Yeah,
which is very sad, you know, to me, that we have people that work in healthcare that would even consider doing such a thing to anybody, you know, abuse, period. But just because that you don't believe in somebody's lifestyle, you're just going to go smack them around. Now, as a healthcare worker.
Because of who they are. And do you think that's what a lot of it is? You know, we see videos on Facebook and everything else of people being abused and in these nursing facilities and stuff. Do you think that that's just, what do you think that stems from? I mean, obviously it's prejudice probably more so than others.
You know, healthcare, because I've been in healthcare all my life, since I graduated high school.
Yeah.
You know, I moved from West Virginia and I started out as a nursing assistant. And from 1994 and a half, I have been in healthcare ever since then. And, you know, back in my day, we were tying people to the chairs with sheets, their wheelchairs with sheets, and strapping them with 4-point restraints in their bed and things. So I've seen it all, you know, and I think we, in healthcare, we take 2 steps forward, but we're still 1 step back. No matter how many 2 steps forward we get, we have 1 step back. And, it comes down to it has to start from the top, the company, from the purchase of a building or the purchase of, or building a new facility. It has to start there and, talking about an inclusive facility or inclusion in a facility, letting the staff know that you hire, that you are an inclusive facility, you know, and is that going to be an issue for you? Because if it is, you don't need to work here.
Right.
You know, that's one thing. And, you know, and also, I think facilities are starting to now, I did see it during Pride Month where their facilities are celebrating Pride for their, not only their staff, but for their residents.
Oh, very nice.
Giving them those things. So it has to start with the owners and operators of the facilities or the healthcare situation, and then training, making sure that there's proper training for their staff. You know, how do you care for an LGBTQ+? Will you care for them like you care for everybody else? That's the answer. You know, it's not rocket science, you know. Right.
Treat them equal as everyone else.
The same way as everybody else.
Sensitivity.
Yeah, and I think we're doing a better job at education, but we still have a long ways to go. I always said I wish I would win the lottery because I would open up one nursing facility, and I would handpick every employee that would work there, and I would have all the flags flying outside. You know, it would be everywhere in the documentation, anything you sign, you know, you would know that you're welcome there no matter what your preference is, the color of your skin, what you like to eat. I don't care. You know, just come and let us take care of you and love on you. That's what that's what we should be. That's what we should be doing.
Right, because they're there for a reason. I mean, obviously, it's not always because they're not loved. But I mean, you know, how often do their families come see them and things that you're all they have?
Right. And in the video, some of these, the elderly LGBTQ+, they don't have families.
Right. Right.
You know, when they came out, they lost their families, you know, and they don't have anybody but the people that work there or their significant other.
We started talking on this episode about Pluto, because that's what Pluto energy is. It's like abuse of power, and like it really like brings forth these things. So it's kind of interesting that we're talking about this, and like you can look like the baby boomers, they were Pluto and Leo, which Leo is, if you think of a lion, it's like pride, right? So like the fact that this is coming back around, like, and I was looking at this resource I have. So when you were in nursing school in 94, you said
yes, that's when I started in nursing.
So that was when Pluto was in Scorpio, and it says here, the power of Pluto in Scorpio as a generation is the ability to expose taboos in order to protect those who are most vulnerable, which clearly that's like what you've dedicated your life to do. So, you know, I think that's pretty amazing.
That is.
I'm a Capricorn too.
Yeah. Well, so right now, this Pluto's been moving through for the since 2008, so there's probably been a number done on you personally.
Oh, but you think, Mikey, yeah. Mona?
I mean,
I could write a. Like, I need Loki. My own TV show or a Lifetime movie is what I need.
Right.
Yeah, you know, it definitely has taken its toll on me. Therefore, that's why I have a lot of tinsel growing in my beard and summer.
But I mean, look at and you're like funneling that into, you're using that to like funnel it into helping others, which I think I have to commend you for. I see the things that you post on Facebook and the productions that you're a part of, and like it warms my heart to know that you are using this Plutonian like transformation and not dying but being reborn in that. So
yeah,
good job.
Well, thank you.
Yeah,
I definitely try to do that.
Yeah, you do. He's a very big hearted person, like, what I like.
Can I ask you a question? Like, do you feel like there, or may I ask you a question?
Sure.
Do you feel like there, so that movie came out in 2010, right?
Yes.
Do you feel like there has been an improvement? Like, because the first thing that comes to my mind is like, so when I was a kid, like in high school, in student council, we would go to the nursing home on like holidays, and like that was part of our community service. And I was a gay little kid, you know, I wasn't out, but I would feel like the kids that are in that position now that are going to nursing homes, like they are much more free. And like, I would hope that would maybe create this space with the elderly and people who are in these spaces to have someone help them come out again if they are back in the closet. You know, like you see that happening.
I do see that happening, you know, and it's funny that you brought that up. One of the facilities that I worked at, I actually had an individual that figured out that I was family, as we like to say, we're family.
And, right. Were you wearing an outfit like this?
I was not. I was probably dressed up as something stupid. I don't know. I don't know what I was doing that day, but it was around Gay Pride time in Charlotte, and they started having a conversation with me, and they asked me if I was going to go to the Gay Pride parade, and I said, I am, and I said, have you ever been? And then that, you know, kind of brought up the conversation, and they made me aware that they were family, and as far as I knew, they were the only LGBTQ plus in our community. But I made sure that their little electric wheelchair that they had, it was decorated. We had a little mini pride parade in the community for them and or for the individual. And but I had to, you know, I had to educate the staff, and I had to educate our what's called resident council as to what we were doing. So it wasn't like culture shock, because, you know, I was Bible Belt here.
Yeah.
And it kind of opened up some things. We actually had a beauty pageant that was judged by a famous drag queen in the Charlotte area. And she became like a frequent flyer of our community. you know, and the elderly men, they would hit on her, and, you know, some of the elderly women would be like, you know, that's a man. And they're like, I don't care. But, you know, it has gotten some better. Again, I think we take two steps forward always, but there's still one step back.
Of course.
Right. And I don't know if that'll ever change, but it doesn't mean that we give up, right?
No, you're right.
Keep marching.
And real quick, as we're closing up, we have a lot of trans people that watch and tune in. How are they affected? That's a tough one, I'm sure.
Girl, you know, it is the hardest of the situations in healthcare right now. Because what happens is you have there's been different situations. There's been young trans women that have, when I worked in skilled nursing, we actually had a young trans woman who came to our community. And there was a debate in our stand-up meeting as to if, before she came, if we were going to accept her, where were we going to put her? Well, you can't just put her with another woman because she's a man. I mean, it was all this hullabaloo, you know, going back and forth. And we did take the individual, and they placed her in a private room. Now, I don't know if they asked. I would want a private room, but to me, I feel like that's a form of discrimination, because why are you going to put me in a private room and you're not going to put everybody else in a private room? You know, right. If you wanted to call it what it is, whatever. But, you know, you also can't tell, you know, if you place a trans woman in a room with a woman, you know, she was born a woman, and the family ask, is my mama's roommate trans? You can't tell them.
Right.
Because of HIPAA.
HIPAA, right.
You know, and then what happens when the trans individual tells the family member, and then you have that, there's a whole, it's a hot mess is what it is, because nobody is educated. And
couldn't that be like a part of a check-in thing? Are you okay to be roomed with a...
In the facility that I would open up,
of course that was
right. It would be a question, but nobody wants to dabble in that because they're afraid,
right?
You know, and that's always going to be the one step back. Yeah. Trans people have an extremely hard time getting care and living in healthcare communities. Yeah. Because of all of the issues that they have, that they face.
Even outside of healthcare.
You know, it's not just a gay man living there. You know, they have all these other, even a, you know, trans man or a trans woman, there's all of these other elements, unfortunately, that people don't understand. And it's just that I feel like I've also witnessed a little bit of abuse in a sense when it comes to staff and not wanting to take care of the individual, because, you know, well, I did hear one time a nursing assistant say, I'm not going to go in there with it. With it.
Right.
And I was like, you know, needless to say, they weren't there very long, but it's just ignorance. It blows my mind at the level of some people's couth about them, I guess you could say.
Right.
The one thing that I wanted to say before we go, because I know we're short on time, is that if you're watching this and you are elderly or baby boomer or anybody really, LGBTQ+, and you are looking at having to get care in a healthcare community, is to go to SAGEUSA.org. It's an excellent resource. They're an advocate for LGBTQ+ seniors and the human rights campaign. And there's a multitude of things that they can help you with. SAGE, SAGEUSA.org. They're a great resource for anybody that's needing help. So, yeah.
Is it correct?
Yes, that is correct.
Perfect. Well, I appreciate you coming in tonight. I know you're getting ready to head out and watch Beetlejuice.
Beetlejuice, don't say it again.
Beetlejuice. Of course, Angel had to say it three times in a row.
Of course she did.
Yeah, in my house of all places, too. Surprised something didn't come flying out of the laundry room at me. But anyway, thank you. I'm glad. We'll have it back on again. Maybe we'll do you and Shane and do a little theater.
Oh, fun.
Maybe we'll just have Shane. The prettier husband.
So, yeah, where I was going to say, where is they on the hierarchy of good looks?
Who, me or him?
No, Shane.
Oh, Shane's very handsome. Very handsome.
He's handsome.
Me is...
I'm the older one, though.
Shane is... Yeah, Shane's got a little baby face. But he's a vocalist, musician, amazing. And what does he do?
So we both work from home, but he teaches, he has a studio downstairs, and he teaches voice, piano, tap, theater, parts of theater, and then he does sound therapy utilizing frequencies, and then he has crystal bowls. Right. And then he's also kind of like a unregistered therapist. So he has does some marriage counseling, you name it. I think he does it. So
we need to do a retreat up here. You and Shane and Anthony, and we'll find somewhere and do it. That would be awesome.
That's actually like on my purview. Like I would love to get into that. Cool. Like hosting space. Like where I'm at in Pennsylvania is like in the woods, but there's like definitely lots of space to hold ceremony and like bring folks together. So I would love to talk more about that.
Yeah, let's start creating. I need to write that down. All right, Bub, I love you.
Every time I'll
see you tomorrow at work.
Yes, don't make me call Angel.
Shut up. You already knew.
Knock him off the line. All right. Have a good night. Bye. Enjoy Beetlejuice.
Hi, Brian.
Bye. Nice to meet you.
Oh, my. All right. And Anthony, thank you so much for tuning in tonight. Before we go, we're going to, and always jumping in when we need you. You've jumped in there for me. You've jumped in tonight for Large Marge a couple times.
Yeah.
We're going to give away.
Isn't it crazy, though, that like I wanted to talk about Pluto and like.
Yeah. It always works out. Doesn't it always work out like that?
Yeah. Yeah. I love it.
So cool.
This and you know, I want to say this, too. Like,
yeah.
I last night before you even asked me, or no, it was after you asked me, but I went upstairs and I was thinking like, what am I going to, cause it was last minute. And I was like, what am I even going to talk about? I mean, there's a lot to talk about, but I couldn't like think of anything. And then I went upstairs and I was like having a hard time falling asleep. So I came downstairs, used the restroom, and I have this, whiteboard on my refrigerator. And I filled this out like maybe over a year ago. And the magnets fell off. Like this was on the floor, like looked like in the kitchen, like facing me when I came downstairs. Like, and I was like, that is so strange. Yeah. So I was like, oh, I'm talking about Pluto.
That is insane. Yeah. We're going to raffle off this. We're not raffling up. We're going to do a little hashtag senior. We've got from Paparazzi this beautiful. Look at that. What is that in there? Is that like a pearl? What is that? Silver dollar shell or something maybe?
It's opal. It's
gorgeous. It's got like a tree on there.
It's like a moon.
It's got a tree and like, oh no, it's like coral. It's not a tree. It's like coral and shells. I don't know if anybody can. There we go. And then it has this, nice. These cute little shell earrings. Got the one flipped upside down. So hashtag senior, one word, all lowercase, senior. Yeah, that's really cool how things just always work out that way.
Yeah.
Really awesome. Here you go, Angel. So you can ship that off to the person that wins. Hashtag senior. And then we're going to get out of here.
Oh, can I say something?
Yeah.
No. So I recently updated my website. So you can go to www.acesofone.com. So
Aces of One, just like periods, like your name underneath your name, you're just Aces of One.
Nope.
Yeah. AcesofOne.com. Always plug in.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you do your own website?
I mean, I did it, but I did it through GoDaddy. So
I just, if you ever need help, you know, I can do that for you because that's what I do.
Well, I want to start, like, I want to figure out a way to do some like drop shipping or like sell some things.
I can help you. Let's drop.
Yeah.
And I'll do it for you. I don't want to charge or anything. I can show you how to do it yourself even. But yeah, real simple. Because that's what I'm actually doing for Daniel and Rowan that have the alpaca farm. We're getting ready to open their store online. And then the one that's on site, they'll be connected through their website and all their inventory will be taken from the
place. I would love that.
Yeah. Yeah. So ready, Angel? Do we have hashtag seniors? Senior in there? Here we go. Who's our lucky winner? Chicken dinner.
I bet it's going to be Devin.
It would be Devin.
Why? Oh, Pam!
I was so close.
I thought it was going to be Devin for me. Pam is always the winner. She has a button or something there.
It's rigged, yeah.
Yeah, she does. I know it. She uses her magic spells.
Yeah, I was going to say she's really good at manifesting.
She's really awesome. I love Pam. She's a good friend and a good fan of ours. And she'll travel. They live in Mansfield, which I don't know if you know. It's pretty far. It's a couple of hours. And they'll drive anywhere to come join us and watch a show. They were at Pride. You might have seen her. She had the moonshine.
I didn't, but I wish I would have seen her.
Right.
Well, so Pam, where's that at? Where's Mansfield?
They're like south-ish.
2.5 southwest.
It's like 2.5 hours from me.
Southwest.
Oh, okay.
Southwest.
In Ohio, though?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was going to say, because September 28th, I'm also doing, it's called Witches Night Out. It's this festival. It's like a witches festival, also in Vermont. It's huge. It's like, it's amazing. Like, they have like a broom dance. They have like a cackling contest. They have like vendors, tarot. Like,
are you calling Pam a witch?
Yeah,
she might be. She might have some. She's got something up her sleeve. I don't know if it's a spell or not, but
I'm calling all witches.
Yeah, right. I'm usually called a bitch. So oh, they have a bitch festival that I can attend.
Same thing. We accept all forms.
Right.
We accept all forms.
Excuse me. I pulled. Excuse me. This is what happens when you get old. I can't cough because I didn't bed last night. I turned and I pulled something in my. I couldn't. I was like, I got a cramp. And it's so sore today.
Oh, like you and the cove?
Yeah. Like one of those cramps. Sorry.
There's a song called Witch, but it's like the acronym. So it's like there's periods in between and it stands for Woman in Total Control of Herself. It's a really great song, actually.
Oh, I like that. I'm going to have to hear that.
Yeah.
Be a new one from my repertoire.
It's a good
one. Well, again, Anthony, thank you so much. And love you to pieces. And we will see you again soon, I hope.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Come see me in Vermont for the psychic fair this Sunday. And then, or if not, check out my website.
Absolutely.
Ace of One.
Unless you're coming to see me in Columbus, people. Okay, come there, too. All right. All right, good night, honey. Thank you.
All right, good night.
That was a great show. We love you all. Thank you for tuning in. And just remember to be kind and love one another. Help each other through hard times and be there. We love you. Have a good night. Are you or someone that you know contemplating suicide or perhaps planning to harm someone else? Or are you organizing a mass shooting? If so, please reach out for help at the nationwide hotline, the helpline at 988. That's right, you just have to dial 988 and a counselor will assist you in the help that you need. Call 988 now. Are you a victim of child abuse or know someone who is? Please notify someone at 1-800-4-A-CHILD. Save a life. Make a change. Or are you or someone you love a victim of domestic violence? Call the people at the Domestic Abuse Hotline at 800-799-SAFE. That's 800-799-7233.